You can now hack your car legally, a printer can also be a fake cell phone tower, and did the Mirai botnet actually take down Liberia? All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morrison. This is ThreatWire for Tuesday, November 8, 2016. Your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. First off, I want to give a big thanks to our patrons at patreon.com/threatwire. You fund the making of this show, so thank you for letting us bring you security news every single week. Our first story. To hack or not to hack? That is the question. When it comes to your personal devices generally, you would want to have all of the manpower that you would need. But for many devices, it's been illegal to reverse engineer their software code or hack the hardware. The DMCA Section 1201 gave companies the ability to submit a lawsuit against any consumer if that consumer hacked their own devices, devices that they had purchased or items that they had owned. Sony and John Deere tractors had both sued and threatened to sue consumers respectively. Allowing customers the ability to hack their own device will have a positive impact. It will allow security researchers to legally reverse engineer code on copyrighted devices and potentially steer manufacturers towards greater privacy and security awareness. The Digital Millennium Copyright Act was updated just last year by the Library of Congress's Copyright Office to allow for exemptions on certain types of hardware and software, including forms of security research and digital repair of vehicles. So yes, you can now legally hack your car. The exemptions went into effect late last week and are on a two-year trial period, just 2 years. Security researchers must use a controlled lab for their own testing so that it doesn't endanger other individuals. I feel like I shouldn't have to say that, but you know, just don't hack people you're not allowed to hack. If all goes well, the ban against reverse engineering could be lifted for good after the next 2 years. Tra-la-la-la-la-la-la. Lol. In a great example of the poor security that we face by using cell phone signals, Julian Oliver, a hacker and artist in Berlin, created a fake cell phone tower inside a regular office printer, like any printer that you would find in pretty much any office, and he called it the Stealth Cell Tower. Oliver used a Raspberry Pi, a Blade RF SDR, two GSM antennas, and an HP LaserJet 1320 to set this up and allowed the device to man-in-the-middle voice calls and SMS messages via GSM. Similarly to the IMSI catchers called Stingrays that saw their moment in the spotlight when government documents were released publicly. Stealth Cell Tower sits near its victims in a regular office printer and spoofs cell towers. Kinda, duh. So when a cell phone connects to it, it can send the phone a text, it can read a text, and it can even print the text messages out on a piece of paper since it's inside a printer. The device can also call a user and play MP3s over the speaker in a person's phone. Oliver wanted to demonstrate the privacy flaws that we deal with on a day-to-day on cell connections and suggested using encryption apps like Signal, which is encrypted end-to-end, so even if a phone does accidentally connect to a spoof tower, it'll still be encrypted. He also mentions that this could be illegal depending on your country, so just don't try this at home. But if you do, the code is on his website. Everybody freak out! Last week, tons of media outlets reported that the Mirai botnet, which uses insecure Internet of Things devices to send tons of garbage data at a victim in an attempt to make their servers basically puke, was used to take down an entire country. That being Liberia in Western Africa. A TLDR version, it actually didn't take down the entire country, clickbait WTF. The claim was that a DDoS attack was maintained against a telecom that owns the one submarine internet cable that goes into Liberia and that the attack was of more than 500 gigabits per second. Now, while Akamai does report a lower traffic level in Liberia during the day of the attack, this could also be because that was a national holiday in Liberia. The submarine cable monitoring system showed no downtime for that day, and multiple sources did confirm that Mirai was used against a telecom provider, but no data shows that it took the entire country offline. So moral of the story, look for multiple sources that can provide actual data to a claim and be skeptical of what what you read on the internet. Don't click on those clickbait titles. Now, we do have a comment of the week this week. Last week, I asked, should counter-hacking be legal? And our comment of the week comes from Sarah D, who writes, in the real world, you have a moral, and in most places legal, right to defend yourself and others against unjustified attacks. In the UK, we have law surrounding the concept of self-defense using reasonable force. As I understand it, the US has similar laws, not to mention the whole Second Amendment thing. Hacking can certainly be considered a weapon, and in my honest opinion, there's a strong moral argument that counter-hacking is simply a form of self-defense, so long as you are within the boundaries of reasonable force, which usually boils down to, you can use enough force to stop the attack, but any additional force is considered revenge rather than self-defense. Thank you so much, Sarah D, for your comment. Of course, you can share your comments on today's stories below for a chance to be featured in next week's episode. Thank you again for being patrons of ThreatWire as well. You can contribute on patreon.com/threatwire to get your name on threatwire.net, which was just updated for our November patrons, as well as your own fur baby in the show, like these ones. I know one of those personally. I know Pooter, he's adorable. He's such a long cat that he can actually reach up to an ice machine and get ice out of a refrigerator. He is so long. If everyone that watches the show donates $1 per month, we would successfully cover all of our fees, like rent, we got bills to pay, like electricity, plus I want to get a new camera for the show. Now, of course, if you cannot contribute, you can give the show a thumbs up and you can subscribe on youtube.com/hack5. Definitely helps and it gets the word out there to a lot more people. I want to see if we can get this episode to 2,000 likes this week. I know that we can do it. I know you guys are watching the show, so just hit that little like button. It doesn't hurt. And you can find all of our episodes, links to our social networks, and other ways to contribute over at threatwire.net. With that, I am Shannon Morse. I will see you on the internet. My Apple box is a skateboard.